Welcome to Mission Minded, the podcast where we explore outside-the-box thinking and carrying out the Great Commission. On this week's episode, we are joined by Jaime, Executive Director of ITEC. Now here's our host, Jim Tingler.
Hello and welcome to the first ever ITEC podcast. We're coming to you live here in Central Florida from ITEC Studios. I'm Jim Tingler, and I am joined by the one and only Jaime Saint.
Hey, Jim. Good to be with you.
Yeah. Hey, it's great to be here. Today, I thought, hey, what a great way to kick off our first podcast and just talk a little bit about what is ITEC? How did it get started? And I know there's a lot to that question, and it goes really to your family history.
Yeah. What I'm going to try to do is, in a very short amount of time, recap the history and really the why of ITEC. So back in the 1950s, my grandfather was a missionary pilot. His name was Nate Saint. In 1956, he, along with four of his friends, were killed by a tribe then known as the Alcas, now known as the Waldani. What a lot of people don't know is that that was really just the first part of the story. The next chapter that God began to write, 2 years later, my great aunt Rachel moved in with the tribe, and 2 years after that, my dad went in. Through a series of events, the man who killed my grandfather, the man's name is Minkai, adopted my dad. Now, we can go into that, but you can read books like End of the Spear, and several others that recap, even the podcast, It's a Jungle Out There. We'll recap the relationship and how that all got started. But in 1994, when Aunt Rachel died of cancer, she was buried out with the Waldani, where she had lived the last half of her life. My dad went down for the funeral. And after the funeral, the tribe came to my dad and said, okay, now that you are family with us, we say that now that Nemo is dead, you come and you live with us. Now, we had taken many trips down through the years, so we did have a family relationship with the Waldani. But my dad, that was not in his plans. And so he said, no. They said, Nemo and Rachel said that you would come, and so he agreed to pray about it. Then they said, no, we've already prayed about it, and we say God says to come. So he said, okay. When we ended up moving down there in 1995, 2 weeks after I graduated from high school, we said, okay, what do you want us to do for you? And they said, we don't want you to do anything. Foreigners are always coming and doing and doing. They come in and they take care of medical problems. They take care of dental problems. They even fly us place to place. But they said there's two problems. One, they only come when it's convenient for them, not when we have a problem. And two, when they come, they can only meet a physical need, but our people have a bigger need than a physical one. It's a spiritual need. They said, so if you teach us how to take care of medical problems, how to take care of dental problems, and even how to fly, then we will not only be here when there is a problem, but we will be able to meet both the physical and share about the spiritual need that they have. We'll be able to share the gospel. Well, that sounded really good, but how do you take somebody from the Stone Age and really bring them to the Space Age? And so we realized, if we're going to do this, we need to reinvent the way we do it here in the U.S. for a developing world culture and context. So that began what has now become ITEC, the Indigenous Peoples Technology and Education Center. Here, what we do is we develop tools to train Christ followers. Then we actually do the training, not here, but in their own context, wherever they are around the world. And then we try to share the vision to other people to multiply that effort.
Right. So, yeah, I know that was a lot, and there is a lot to the story, but, you know, The crazy thing to me about the story, I've heard it a lot, you know, and just going back and thinking that even though your dad, Steve Saint, started ITEC, it was really the Waldani's idea.
Yeah. we could not see anything other than traditional missions because we come from a very domineering society and culture. And so we always figured that our job was to go and plant churches, to go and be missionaries and run those churches, to go and build things because we can build better, we can do better than anybody else, at least that's what our mind tells us. But the Waodani from their side, they said they felt the debilitation of dependency. They were always dependent on outsiders. And so they came and they said, you come and you teach us. And they could do that. They didn't ask, they told, because we were family. And they didn't want us to say no. They said, look, you come and you teach us. And once we lived down with the Waodani, we began to see the impact of dependency on a culture. We saw missions from the receiving end. And missions from the receiving end looks totally different from the going end, from the doing end. But because of that relationship, how God orchestrated that, they had the freedom. Because when my dad was young, they taught him how to live in the jungles. And so they said, okay, you come, you went back to the outside world, you come and you teach us what you learned there so that we can really help our people and not just physically, but share the gospel with them.
Right. And a lot of that, the ideas and just wrestling through that is covered in Steve Saint's The Great Omission book. And the key takeaway that I found in reading that book is that really the great omission is not including the indigenous church in the great commission.
That's exactly it. Because we go and we think that we should go and do everything for everybody forever, which is what my dad said in that book. But churches began to get this concept. There's other books like When Helping Hurts and Toxic Charity and others that have come along. But churches started getting that idea. Okay, how do we do it better? How do we do it differently than what we currently do? And so we did a series called The Missions Dilemma, seven-part DVD series that you and I have been through together. And what that did is that had people from around the world, they were having missions done to them, share with the church in the West, which includes the United States, how they feel about that. And you know, it really wasn't very pretty, but it was very eye-opening.
Yeah, absolutely. And the desire that the Waodani had in Ecuador, it wasn't just unique to them. Globally, there's the desire to be involved, but the process to be able to train somebody, you might need to rethink that. And that's where ITEC has really taken that and run with it in developing training, maybe developing tools, and then the goal would be to not only train, but then equip others to do the same.
Right. So when you talk about developing tools, redesigning what we use here in the U.S. to overseas, that takes outside the box thinking. You need to strategize. How can we boil something down to just the very basics? And then you have to be very systematic or inside the box, as we like to say, when you actually go and train. But then you also have to start thinking outside the box and inside the box when you try to equip others to do the same. And that's really, I think, the reason behind this podcast is to challenge people in the church,
right?
Challenge Christ followers. Hey, you don't have to just come with ITEC on a trip.
Right.
We can help to equip you so that you can use the God-given talents and skills and abilities that you have to go in a place where we don't have a relationship, but that church or that person does, to go and equip Christ followers there. It's not just about humanitarian equipping people. It's about equipping Christ followers to meet a physical need as a door opener to share the gospel.
Right.
That's what Jesus did. Jesus came, he healed people,
right,
and then people followed him because there was something different. People don't care about what you know until they know that you care. But once they know that you care for them, you can speak truth into their lives and they will listen because you have demonstrated love to them.
Right. And so, yeah, I know that's a lot of stuff to unpack, but I think it is important to lay a foundation for where we're going to go. You know, our goal with this podcast isn't to talk about ITEC and everything we're doing, but it is important to just lay a foundation of how we got here. You know, we started as an organization over 20 years ago, and it's been a journey. It's a learning process. We're still learning. We're still growing. I think one of the big differences for ITEC is that often when people think short-term missions, they think of going and doing something, whatever that may be. And so ITEC, as an organization, we're thinking about how can we go and train. And so that's, you know, our team here, you know, different backgrounds and talents all coming together with that purpose. And so we'll talk more about that for other podcasts another time. But what is your role with ITEC today? And maybe where do you see ITEC going forward?
Yeah. So I'm the executive director here at ITEC, which means that I get to empower the people who are on the bus to do the jobs that God has brought them here to do. You know, ITEC, really, we've done an excellent job with training. We're not the only training organization. There's other organizations out there that we have a relationship with that are doing a fantastic job. I think really where we're also very talented is in our development, redesigning tools to be able to be used in a third world or developing world context. So we're really good at training. We're not the only organization that's focused on training in other places around the world. There are several other organizations that really are doing a great job. You know, as far as the developing, we have a very talented engineering team that really have done some incredible redesign work, taking things from the space age and redesigning them for the developing world. And where we're going forward, one of the key areas, you know, as we look to the future, is the equipping side. How do we take this and multiply it, not just in the areas, the six or seven areas that we're focused, but how do we equip others with this vision to take the talents that they have, to use those in the mission field by empowering Christ followers when they have relationship.
Right. So so what you're saying is we want to encourage others to think the same way of what if they went and trained in their, you know, mission efforts. Oftentimes, again, we're thinking, what could we go and do? And so I think part of this podcast is we want to process through what that might look like. What if you started taking a look at what you're doing and started involving training? That would be the local church, wherever that might be.
Right. Our goal is not to make ITEC big. It's for the name of the Lord to be magnified around the world, for His kingdom to advance, not for ours. And so there's people out there that may be very talented in something that we're already doing. And we've already had contacts with people like that. And we've said, look, if there's anything that we have that you can use, use it. But we want to make sure that they're training Christ followers and not just training for humanitarian purposes alone.
Right, right. So I think that's a good place to stop for this first episode. This is Jim. Enjoyed having you here for this podcast. We look forward to you joining us for future podcasts as we unpack this. There's a lot to this discussion, and we want you to be a part of it. So we look forward to seeing you on the next episode.
Thank you for joining us for this week's episode of Mission Minded. For more information on today's topic and show notes, please visit our website, itechusa.org.